Hey everyone, we're gonna see how this goes. Hopefully the stream looks all right. It's not too choppy. All right. So if this works, if you're new here, welcome. If you're in the chat, basically, if you're watching and you have questions, drop a comment. We can chat about headphones, high-end audio, whatever it may be. Welcome to the chat. Welcome to the video. I didn't start working on the amp yet because I just started the stream, but if you have questions, drop it in the chat. And we can talk about headsets, audio, gaming. This is a good day to nerd out. So thanks for stopping by.
Welcome to the chat. Welcome to the video.
This is going
to
be echoey. I didn't start. This isn't like a full-on professional stream setup right now. I just figured I was working on an amp and I might as well stream while I do it in case people had questions on stuff, whether it be from prior reviews or videos I made or whatever it may be. But basically I have a Burson audio headphone amp that is also a Class AB speaker amp, all integrated, so there's a volume knob on it. And I had a defective PCB, so Burson audio sent me a replacement. And I'm going to work on swapping that out and see if that works. See if it's like the other one. All right. I should probably throw in some keywords for the stream as opposed to just going live, but this was kind of unplanned. So. But yeah. Whoever is watching out there, if you have questions, drop it in chat. I'll keep checking when I can. I don't know how up to date my my feed is, but I'll do my best. Let's see. Looks like we're okay right now. Yeah, we're doing good. I'm just throwing in a couple chat tags in the stream to help people find it if they're looking for it. So I will come back to chat in a moment. Definitely should do live chat instead of love chat. I don't want to get the wrong people here. All right, that should work. All right, so I think we're good there. And I'll be back on the stream to see if there's any questions. We look good. All right, so good to see you. I think two or three people are watching right now. I don't really know how good the analytics are on Streamlabs, which I'm using right now. I literally just installed Streamlabs. I plugged in my camera HDMI into my laptop with the Elgato Cam Link, turned it on and hit record. So I don't have any fancy scenes. I did set up some default one, but So if you're here for the Burson audio chat, this is a Burson Funk. It's like $540-ish headphone amp that also has a Class AB speaker amp. You can see the larger transistors towards the top of the PCB. I don't know how well that's... Actually, that doesn't look too bad. So there are a lot more screws than I anticipated, so I'm going to have to look at how this is connected. I wish I could do the top-down view with dual cam links, but that's not possible with the laptop, so maybe I will work on that at one point. So this is the replacement PCB, and I'll show you, that might be easier to present. So there are screws for all the transistors. The PCB itself, looks like the speaker binding post just unplugged. So basically, I had some issues with the headphone out not always working. It was really staticky, and if I if I used the speaker outs or was messing around with audio sources, it was completely dead. No idea why. So let's see if the replacement fixes that problem. All right. I think I can get by. Let's take the volume knob off. I am hoping that that's all I need to unscrew. I might see if unscrewing the front. Yeah, I think I have to actually. That might be my only way. There is no field guide or manual on how to take this thing apart completely, so bear with me if I get something really wrong. I definitely don't want to break anything. So that screws in there. Interesting. That is a little too tight for comfort, I'm not going to lie. Welcome to the chat. I'm trying to figure out how to take this apart without breaking it, so this could be a total waste of time. See some screws there, so that's good, because that's solid. So I'm going to start with the back screws, and for those who are watching in chat, if you have questions about anything audio or the channel or whatever you want to talk about, as long as it's appropriate, drop it in chat. I'd be happy to chat with you. I'm kind of just screwing around today, so I thought I'd turn on the stream while I did so. Swapping out a PCB for a Burson audio amp that did not quite work out of the box. I don't know if it got damaged in shipping or whatnot. So they sent me a replacement replacement PCB. And I just thought I'd turn on the camera while I worked on it. So if I'm too quiet, too loud, it's blurry, choppy, whatever is going on with the stream, feel free to comment about that as well. As I figure this out. So that part's straightforward. I don't know why the front isn't coming off after I've unscrewed everything. It's like really on there. I don't know if it's just because it's attached to the... Okay. It's the volume knob that's stuck. Okay, I'm not smart. I can see what the issue is. Hey, welcome to the stream. I see more people coming in. I'm just working on an amp, and I did not script this or decide how I was going to do this. I just figured while I'm working on this, I'll turn on the stream. Hey, Dexum, how's it going, man? Yeah, so I decided to... this had to get fixed because I actually have to release a review on this. I'm a little past due, but I had issues with the... one that this came with, the PCB that was included. Headphone output didn't work. It was staticky. I had to move it around a lot, and then my AB speaker out wasn't working correctly. And when I switched the op amps, which are the little audio processors, if you will, this is basically what's doing your DSP. It didn't work. Like, it would boot up and then fail. The Fun, which is a smaller version, this is just a headphone amp. This has a speaker amp built into it. That one worked fine even when I switched the op amp, so I know it wasn't the op amp. Good to hear. I see that I think two or three people are watching right now. If you have questions about audio in general, prior headphones, headphone comparisons, what the heck this thing is, feel free to throw it in chat and I'll do my best to answer it. I don't have any fancy streaming stuff set up. I kind of just turned on the camera and figured I'd stream while I worked. So nothing crazy exciting today. I'll be doing more headphone and headset reviews soon because I have the new Sony InZones headphones, which are quite the interesting thing to cover, to be honest. It was kind of shocking. I think this looks all right. So I'll do the PCB screws next. I have a top-down camera now, if anyone watched my most recent review, but I don't have two capture cards to do dual cameras at once yet. I'll work on that, because I think that'd be cool. And I'm basically right now slowly looking for extra screw holes to see what I'm missing to determine when it's the right time to pull this out. And it looks like I already did it. So this is the defective PCB, $100 to $150 headphones. Now I understood, you're good. It kind of depends. So I'm gonna ask you questions first before I give some answers, because 100 to 150 is, I mean, in almost every price range, you have a ridiculous amount of options. So I guess all the platforms you may use it on, is it going to be used on, so that might be part of the problem. Is it going to be used on PC, console, phone, combination of them all? Do you need it to be wireless? Are you using it for chat? Those types of things. But whatever information you can provide would be great. I just got thermal grease on my little mouse pad here. So this has extra pads on it, and this one did not. Might as well show the two PCBs side by side. So this is the new one. It's definitely different. I think that's a new thing. I'm gonna assume I can install this without having to remove those pads, because I don't see why they would put it on in the first place. I'm gonna put this here. It might have just been for shipping, actually, now that I look at it, but I'm gonna see if it goes on without causing any issues. If it doesn't fit, and it does not, so I guess I do have to remove those pads. Okay. All right, so 7.1 surround and a mic, PC and console. So the 7.1 stuff is really just on the PC side. Oh, cool, Jacob. I'll talk about the Nova Pros. I actually have them out right now. So the virtual sound processing on console is all done by the console. So any standard headset can benefit from the same virtual surround. That includes Dolby Atmos, and it includes the PlayStation Tempest 3D audio engine. This is so weird pulling foam off of this board. I really feel like I should have gotten this to work. So,
do you need it for wireless? Let's see. You
didn't mention if you needed it with wireless or not. So on, I don't know of a wired USB 7.1 headset that works on Xbox. So if you want to let me know if it's Xbox, PlayStation, and PC, and we can try to narrow it down from there. $100 to $150 range, SteelSeries makes a pretty competitive product. You know, the Arctis 5s and 7s are pretty good. They just need some EQ tuning, although there's those question marks about durability. I do like the Corsair HS80 a lot for the money. With a little bit of EQ, that headset is just amazing, especially if you primarily play on PC. Cool, David, that's great to hear. So the stream's picking up a little bit, and I appreciate everyone stopping by. For those who just tuned in, I literally just wanted to repair a headphone amp, and while I was doing that, I figured I'd turn on the camera and chat with you all. If you have questions on this stuff, how this tech works, what makes this thing over $500, whatever, we can chat about that too. So Wireless better. I think wired would be cool too. Yeah, so if you're not playing on Xbox in that price range, I really do like the HS80s just because they're really, really comfortable to me. I had a great experience with them. I still have them. I have every headset I've ever reviewed or purchased, even if I haven't reviewed it. But I like those. I'm looking at my collection right now. The EPOS H3 Pro Hybrids are a little glitchy sometimes, and they're a little bit beyond that price range. So I say SteelSeries Arctis 5 and 7, depending on the feature set you want. The Black Shark V2 Pros are a little outdated now because they're just micro USB, so I'm not a big fan of that. And the new Barracudas have an integrated mic boom array, or a mic array in the sides of the ear cups, so the microphones aren't that great in case you need it for chat. So let me think. So HS80, believe it or not, it's Turtle Beach's prices went up. The Stealth 700 Gen 2 is amazing for the money.
Yeah,
I'll spell it out for you. Let me type it in chat real quick. So I haven't done this type of stream before. I've actually never streamed on my laptop, and it's asking me to sign in to chat. So that's insane. Give me a sec here. So Corsair HS80, SteelSeries.
Yeah, you know, I like the Barracuda's sound quality and comfort, actually more so than the Nova Pros, but the mic can be a deal breaker for a lot of people.
Arctis.
Did I spell it right?
5 and 7. Try to get the Plus if you can. The Plus is the new version. I know there's like the P version and then no P. The P just means it's PlayStation certified.
So let's see what else I'm... Okay, so the Nova Pros, Jacob, and you can ask more questions, Dexum, if I didn't fully answer. I'm going to keep thinking about more in that price range because wireless with multi-channel is, you know, kind of a gray area.
So the Nova Pros I do like a lot. I was just using them again because I was comparing it to the new Sony InZones, the H7. And that was, or the H9 actually, and that was a little bit of a letdown. I can talk about those afterwards, but I think where SteelSeries kind of messed up was the comfort. I don't know what the hell made them put such a big microphone setup in the center of the ear cup. And I can always, if I have time after the stream and this is still going, I'll remove the pad so you can see what I'm talking about. But the wireless version, excuse me, has active noise cancellation, which requires having a mic bump inside because they have to hear the inside audio versus exterior audio or external audio in order to properly isolate the sound. So the problem is the microphones inside the Nova Pros are kind of big. It can lead to long-term comfort issues. It wasn't really a problem for me for the time I used it when I was doing my review. And last night, it was getting a little annoying. I don't know if I just adjusted it or put it on differently, but it's not, it could have been more comfortable. I think Sony's H9 and the Barracuda Pro has a much more comfortable active noise cancellation design. And the H3 Pro Hybrids have probably the best comfort for active noise canceling headphones. I don't even know if they have a mic bump. I didn't even notice it. I guess I could check it out. The ear pad. So here's what's weird. And I haven't covered this yet because I buy most of my headsets because I don't want companies to kind of want them smaller, but I don't want to feel pressure by any company to appease to them. I'm fortunate enough that I have a day job so I can at least afford to buy these once in a while. But the wired version of the Novas don't have the microphone bump, but the ear pads are more shallow. And with the ear pads being more shallow, you lose the seal because basically the pads resting on your ear. You don't have a lot of pressure to preserve bass. And with the more shallow ear cups, it affects the soundstage a little bit, but you also lose bass performance. So believe it or not, out of the box, the wireless version of the Nova Pro actually has better bass response than the wired version. So even though the wired version can technically sound a little bit better, a lot of people may like the wireless version more just because they seem to have more bass without requiring custom EQ and stuff.
So, let's see.
The Sonys look nice. Yeah, they, you know, here's, I try to avoid dropping my opinions on what looks great or doesn't, because it's all subjective. I mean, obviously there's an area where it gets ridiculous. If something is very high end, I'll be sure to point that out. Or if something looks really cheap for the money, I will be sure to point that out. But in that middle range, unless there's some glaring issue, it's really just up to you and what you think sounds good, looks good, is comfortable, reasonably priced, etc.
Acer Nitro headphones, yeah.
Yeah, so let me grab them. You know, we'll do this. This will be a fun little Q&A. Give me a second. This is very informal. We're going to have fun. So I do a lot of testing, and my reviews have been slower because I tend to over-test stuff. So these are the H9s that I just got a little dirty here. The H9s have this leather. I think it's fake leather. It feels fake. They do have the microphone bump, but the pads are deeper, and the bump isn't as extreme as the Nova. They are durable. It's this weird matte white plastic. Honestly, it looks a little cheaper than I would expect at almost $300, especially because Sony can make some really nice quality stuff. Sound quality is decent. I don't want to ruin my review. I think the microphone is a letdown. For having a boom, it's one of the lower quality mics I've heard, especially at this price range. I mean, it gets pretty much destroyed by most other wireless headsets in that price range. The Turtle Beach, Stealth Series, EPOS all have noticeably better mics. And of course, Corsair mics are amazing.
Logitech G733.
I think they're good. I just wasn't a fan of their ear cup designs. They didn't seem to be as comfortable. But sound quality wise, it's okay. They're kind of the same philosophy as Sony. I think the Logitechs have just kind of an unoffensive sound profile. They don't have tons of bass. They don't have really sharp highs. They just kind of skirt the line in the middle, and then you can custom EQ it to make it the way you want. So that's nice. So, hey Gareth, welcome to chat, man. Talking to you live. One of my bigger supporters. I see you chatting on a lot of my videos, so I appreciate that. If I get sidetracked, I tend to wander. My head goes all over the place when I do my reviews, and you don't see that because I edit it. But if I forget to fully answer a question, don't feel bad about asking me again. Yeah, I have the H9 here, so my friends are a lot. Luckily, I play with the same group of guys for years, and they tell me if my headset sounds like trash or not. And my buddy Corey, I don't think you're watching the chat, but He is not afraid to be very descriptive in how bad some of these microphones sound, and he was not impressed with the H9. And I don't say anything about what it is, the price. I just say, okay, can you hear me? How does my mic sound? And then I proceed to get roasted or say it sounds fine or however extreme we want to go.
Bookshelf speakers to the PC with a headphone out. So, hey, Sam, funny enough, depending on your price range,
I'm actually holding one that is like pretty high end. Now I'm going to test and see how good it really sounds here soon. But this is the Burson Audio Funk. I don't know how expensive you want to go. This is about $540, and it's a Class AB amp on the output, so I can power speakers like my Bowers and Wilkins speakers. And it also has I think it's 3.6 watt RMS headphone out. Two dedicated amps, one for the speakers, one for the headphone. It has microphone pass-through, but in my testing so far, there's a grounding issue, so you may get a little bit of a buzz. When you get into headsets with mics and high-end audio, it becomes more challenging. So let me think of a better way to answer that.
Bookshelf speakers to a PC.
I guess it depends on how big and powerful your bookshelf speakers are. And with headphone out, if you just need a headphone out, this will still work fine. Topping probably make some of the best out there as far as overall performance for the money. And I'll try to get the model number as soon as I can.
Yeah, this is the stream picking up. I'm not watching how many people are on. Cool. That's about the budget. Yeah, so the Burson, let me type it out just in case.
I'll have a review of this coming as long as this replacement PCB works. Burson Funk topping, just Google topping, and there's a couple out there that
do it. Thank you, Jacob. I appreciate that. Yeah, this would be a good option.
This doesn't have a DAC. It's just an analog amp, which can be better. A lot of times some amps try to do more than they should, and they can hurt the sound. So I'm going to pray that I got this right, and I may try to hook this up here momentarily and see how it sounds. I'll just hook my phone up to it. Ooh, KEF Q150s. Those are awesome. I actually have a pair of those in my the den, the kids' little play area. I just bought the Q150s and I think the QC350 for the center. That they image incredibly well. They work really well as near field monitors, which basically means they can be really close. I use SVS and I've been really happy with it because of the integration with the subwoofer. So I think I'm done with this. This looks good. The Blue Yeti, I do like the Blue Yeti. It's very clear. The Blue Yeti is a different approach to what some new mics are doing because the Yeti actually has multiple microphone capsules, front and rear. So if you're not doing two-way recording and you always record in front of it and you disable the back to do what's called a cardioid pattern, which focuses all your audio pickup up front. If you do that, you are basically paying for capsule space that you're not really using. So I do like the clarity of it. However, I think that some other microphones on the market give you a little bit better performance, depending again on what you want. The smaller capsules can distort once in a while that the Blue Yeti uses. So I like the neat microphones. They have huge capsules. They have a nice warm tone. So for a voice like mine, I prefer to have a warmer sounding microphone. I don't want it too shrill or sharp. On the USB side, I do enjoy, this is not lined up, is it? I do enjoy the Elgato Wave, actually, because they have the Wave 3, and that one works really well.
Buy headphones and mic on the side. iFi Zen V2 amp. I don't think I have that one.
I gotta check. iFi is great stuff for the money. I do like the Zen. I just got the Zen Signature, actually, because it's powering my HiFiMan planars with those for upcoming review. I'm just giving away everything I'm reviewing, but that's totally fine. Let's see. So this is unscripted. My wife texted. I'm gonna make sure we're good here.
All right. Yeah, Wave 3 is Elgato.
The reason why is it depends what you're going for. I use XLR mics when I can because they have a higher dynamic range, which means you get more headroom to work with both on the low volume and the higher volume. And when you do that, if you're playing a game and you're talking quiet, you want to be able to pick that up clearly. And if you do that, you want to also not distort when you yell. So if you get really excited about a game or animated, I think it sounds pretty bad when someone yells on the stream and it clips out and it sounds all distorted. So usually I like XLRs for that. The problem I've had with the Blue Yetis is they distort easier than other more recent technology USB mics. So while it sounds good if you're in that narrow decibel range, it can be exposed, the weakness can be exposed, ooh, almost lost it, when you start shouting or getting like animated or your voice changes a lot. So the Wave 3, even though it's not like a perfect sound quality mic, I think it still sounds great. The software obviously is robust, but it's a little bit more resource intensive. But I like the Wave mics because if you yell, they typically don't distort. Not only do they have some benefits on the hardware side to help give you a little bit more dynamic range, but the software that they give you, the Wavelink, has something called ClipGuard, which will adjust the gain very, very quickly to make sure you're not clipping out on your stream. And I think that's honestly more important than pure sound quality if you're just looking for a USB mic, because one can sound just, I guess, slightly better, but if it's distorting whenever you yell, what's the point?
So, clear-cut winner for closeback.
That gets dangerous because I don't like to pick favorites. Here's the thing. I am on a quest to find what I feel could be the perfect headset out there. And what I am learning after, I think, owning about 70 pairs is there isn't one. And it's really frustrating because I would love to just have one or two headsets out all the time. I like the VZR Model 1 a lot, which is $350. Guys, I used the wrong screws on a couple spots. That's what I get when I talk and work. Here it is. I like the VZR Model 1. However, the microphone sensitivity isn't that strong. So if I'm playing on Xbox, which doesn't give you adjustable mic gain, my friends can't hear me that well. And the Astro Mixamp Pro has a pretty weak microphone preamp because it's designed for the A40s, which have a very sensitive mic. So I can't even fix it if I bypass the DAC. The only one I haven't tried yet that I'm actually hoping to is I want to use the Astro VZR on the SteelSeries Arctis Nova DAC because that DAC has a very strong mic gain, and that could be the golden ticket to fix my issue with the Model 1. The Model 1 does not have a very bright, I'm dropping the screw like 50 times. A lot of people may or may not like the Model 1 sound signature. It has a lot of bass presence, a lot of bass energy, and as a result, it'll seem like the mids are overpowered by the bass and the highs. You can EQ it. I did drop the 80 hertz range down a little bit, but on certain games, it is very easy to pinpoint footsteps. They just have incredible imaging. So for FPS, as long as you cut the bass down a little bit, they are insane.
Yeah, so was it Cellini? I'm sorry if
I'm pronouncing your tag, your username incorrectly. If you're having mic issues, I guess answer in the chat. Did you get a long boom on your mic, or was it a short boom like mine? And I can get mine and show you. We'll go from there. Because they apparently are coming out with a longer boom, and that might fix some of the noise sensitivity issues. It'll put the mic closer to your mouth. Yeah, I want to get some Arias. They have some, there's some really nice IEMs out there. So just to let the cat out of the bag, I'm really trying to get more into that type of the audio as well. I don't want the channel to be focused solely on gaming headsets because I really like the higher end audio stuff. And Arias are, I guess I don't know if they pronounce it differently than what HiFiMan calls their headphones, but they have some really high value, like great value IEMs, like under $100, and they sound great. So I'm hoping to get a few pairs to start doing the reviews. Oh, so the mic almost touches the corner of your mouth. Let me see how mine lines up. This is almost assembled. So let me grab my VZR.
All right, Dexum.
Appreciate you, man, or lady. Thanks for stopping by. So, I have a few cables here. These are my EPOS wires, the VZR. Here's the Model 1, and I think the microphone is still in the case, so I'm going to grab that.
Thank you. Yeah,
so Chase,
Wait, you over the heads. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you were the one who mentioned the IEMs. I do like newer wireless earbuds for travel, I think more than headphones now, because they've come a long way in sound quality. And when I travel, I like to travel light. And even though I love the sound quality of big headphones, it's really not great to travel with. they take up a lot of space. So IEMs and wireless earbuds, if you can find one that is comfortable, some people can't stand the comfort of stuff that goes in your ear. But if you find a set that's comfy and you get one that has a good sound profile, they can be a great pickup. I'm going to get the microphone here in a second because I want to see. It's almost double the length of the original mic. And the the owner of VZR, Vic, I talk to him every couple weeks because he's a big audio nut. And we've chatted, and he wants to send me a longer mic boom so I can test the differences. So I'll be doing a video on that too. Let me get the mic. Well, it's turning into a fun stream. I appreciate all the questions and comments here. So this, by the way, is the VZR case. If anyone didn't watch the stream, I love this case. It's just enough to fit the headphones and give you all your gear. So this is the short mic boom. Wish I could measure it. I guess we'll use your ear pad as an example. So if your microphone looks kind of like this, as far as left to right, you have the short one. I don't know if this is a great example of length, but the longer one gives you like an extra inch and a half or 2 inches of mic boom, and it'll put it more in front of your face as opposed to close to the side. So let me plug this in real quick. I'll eventually do some kind of little studio tour too if you guys want to see this layout. Yeah, so this is right at the corner of my mouth. The longer boom will put the mic closer to in front. So it might pick up some more plosives, so like strong P's. Might pop the mic a little bit, but it should capture more energy from your voice and it therefore be a little bit louder. So if you don't have that, I think it's info@vzraudio.com. Ask about the mic sensitivity, and Vic is a nice guy. He might actually just hook you up or give you something real reasonable to get you a longer boom.
Yeah, I've heard about the Linsols, Gareth. I haven't listened to them yet.
I go to the headphone shows like Can Jam and stuff, and I listen to some really expensive IEMs, but I wasn't into them enough last year to spend too much time on it. I'd love to, though. I'll check them out. I've heard great things about them. Yeah, Chase, are you using like a Magni Modi type stack? That's a pretty common one. I have the Hell 2 because of the gaming headset side. The Hell 2 with the VZR Model 1 is an amazing combo, by the way. So, of course, now I have to figure out how this PCB should get put back in. I guess I should put the pads back on the bottom just so I don't damage it more shipping it to them.
Cool.
I appreciate everyone stopping by the stream. This was unscripted and we got some pretty active chat, so thanks for that. Figure we chat while I work. The kids were out playing with the wife and their friend, so let's put this here. So that covers that.
I may try to plug it in. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great stack, in my opinion. I'm going to plug this in real quick and maybe I'll connect my phone. I'll see if I can get any kind of audio out of this. So we'll find out. I don't know if you guys can even see me on the stream. I can't see myself right now, but I'll be right there. This would be great if it worked. Thank God for banana clips. All right, I'll bypass this. I'm coming back, Chad, I promise. This was not successful. Well, that was unfortunate. I'm going to give that a little time in case it has to warm up. But unfortunately, it's not turning on yet. So we'll see how that goes. I definitely switched the right one. The other one did turn on. So if I have to, I'll go back to that.
Thanks, Chase.
Yeah, I want to go live more. This setup took me over a month to build. I mean, this room's fairly long. I have a full computer headphone testing side over there for my editing and content work. Obviously, I have the review bench. I built this tabletop I get the motorized top so I can bring my stuff up and down on camera. And then my two-channel audio listening where I test, you know, more powerful amplifiers. I have a couple other rooms for audio, but the dual OLED gaming side for console testing for all the headsets, and I have some gear racks to swap things out a lot. So this has come a long way from my little 10 by 12 foot room I used to do all my testing in. Tripods take a lot of space. All the lighting and gear filled the entire room.
I saw ATH. Oh man. Yeah, the
G1WL, that, remember that review? That was, I felt a little embarrassed of that review, to be honest. My production quality wasn't quite that great, and it's really hard when you have young kids to film sometimes. So I was trying to make do with what I had. I also had a much different camera gear set up. I'm really disappointed that that amp did not turn on. I really hope it's something that I missed inside, because there's no reason why that shouldn't work. I believe the op amps are in it. I might even take it back apart depending on how much time I have on the stream. This is the smaller version of the Burson audio headphone amp. This is the Fun. They discontinued this. This was $300. The Funk is like $540, and it has this $300 headphone amp in it, and then I think like another $300 or $400 speaker amp built into it. So they combined both and gave you a really nice package, provided it works. So, man, I really like things to work the first time, so that's going to get to me a little bit. Let's see. If you have other questions, chat, don't hesitate to ask. I think now that I've swapped the PCB, I may either open it again, or I'll troubleshoot the power out here while I work. See if I missed any questions. Oh, I did miss one. G6 Sound Blaster X, if money is not an issue, which amp deck is awesome for this headset? Oh yeah, and you have the Model 1. So here's the thing. The Sound Blaster X actually has some awesome features in it, and the Model 1 is really, really efficient. The sensitivity rating is crazy high. So more power may not give you better sound necessarily, because the other things change. Your DAC, your audio processing, etc. So even though more power technically is better, that's only if all other factors are considered the same. And Sound Blaster, especially on the processing side, for gaming, virtual sound, EQ, and all that, it actually has some pretty good sound characteristics to it. So when you get into more serious power, it's more for when you're not concerned with microphone. So if you're not concerned with microphone, I guess let me know in chat, and we'll talk about some higher-end headphone amps that give you a lot of juice. But even then, you'd still want to do some kind of EQ software. I use Equalizer APO on the computer because it's open source, and then I do the piece add-on, and the piece add-on kind of makes it a prettier UI. I'm going to repack the Model 1s for now just because it's here. I do not understand why that amp did not turn on. It's getting to me. I know I packed everything correctly. So hopefully looks like we're okay on chat right now. So chat's a little quiet. If you have questions on other stuff or I didn't fully answer something, let me know. I'm going to unplug this. Let's see. The wires. It's all about the wires. Okay, well, that explains why that didn't work. I used the wrong power supply, possibly. Okay, yep, we're good. And I heard a pop. Yes, please. This is unscripted, if you can't tell. So my power supply has power,
and yet this does not. 24 amp. Yeah, it's the right power supply. That's disappointing.
Yeah, and I think
I haven't seen anything change on chat, so unless I'm mistaken here, I think I answered your question, JCTV. I am interested in IEMs. I have to cover more for sure. Just have not had the opportunity. I have too many things I'm reviewing right now. So I'm admittedly with the whole move, I threw my back out pretty bad, had to move to a different state. Things got delayed at the new house. And yeah, I lost like a month and a half of work potential. So now I have a lot of products that I have to review to catch up. And then I would love to keep revisiting other more categories, especially on the audio side. And because I live in a new neighborhood, there's a lot of construction happening outside. So there's a lot of noise outside right now. Part of why I didn't want to film a review today, because I didn't know what to expect for background noise. So, let's see. Chat's quiet. If you guys want to talk about anything, it doesn't have to just be audio or about my channel. Obviously keep it appropriate, but this is more of a hangout session while I work. So, I can talk about op amps, I guess, maybe. It's inside the fun. This is frustrating, because if I go through two PCBs after all that and it still doesn't work, that really is kind of ridiculous. The first one worked.
Okay, so all the screws are there, so it's grounded. Speaker terminals are good. Power supply is soldered, so we have a good connection there.
Yeah, I'm nervous about custom KBs. I've been watching them and researching them, and yeah, that's a very time-dedicated category. I don't like to get into too many different things too aggressively, because unless I understand it a lot and I can feel confident in everything I'm saying, I don't like to talk about it as much, because I'd hate to be a channel that gives the wrong information out. But yeah, I agree that I think it would be a lot of fun to try. This does not seem right. I have a multimeter, but I didn't expect to need it. It was in the garage. So everything's lined up well. I don't like the way this is lined up, but that's just the input, so that won't affect power. I don't get it, guys. I'm gonna check actually to see how the headphone jack fits on this one compared to the last one. That one's nice. So I'm gonna try to see if I can get this in camera. I really wish it was more clear. No, that's not gonna work. I'm gonna swing around, and I wanna show you something inside this. Okay. So if you can see those headphone pins, I'm gonna put this in. You can actually see them lift when you plug in a headphone. Kind of like the way a lock works on a door. So, little science thing. I don't know if that was cool to anyone or not. I just like seeing the way things work. So when you feel the little clicks as you're pushing it in, that's basically a mechanism inside. That's how it looks.
Yeah, Gareth, I don't know if I can do it.
I agree they're nice, though. I know they feel nice, but Yeah, I use Rock Hat and Corsair keyboards most of the time. I've been pretty happy with them, especially if it matches or integrates with the software I use. I've pretty much always used Rock Hat for a couple years now. I use the Vulcan and Burst and the Cone XP that just came out. I actually got, I don't know if I'm allowed to talk about it. I'm going to check to see if something's under embargo or not, and then I'll show you something that's coming out. I don't know if it's fully announced yet. But I recently switched my desk over to full Corsair to try a different mouse and keyboard combo and see how well that integrates with IQ, because I have to use IQ for my liquid cooler and the case fans, and it's okay. I'm not used to the keyboard actuation pressure. It seems to be very soft. I have more typos than my Vulcans. What was I going to check? I'm thinking about the whole setup here. I'll probably come back to that. I'm going to get the power supply un-Velcroed. Oh, let me see if that's the family coming back. All right, we're good. Yeah, I'm going to unplug the power supply. I want to see if I get any juice out of it up here. And yeah, I'll take a look back on chat. To organize my wires, which is a lot of Velcro and twist ties, which stinks when you need to unplug something. Okay, so I have the power supply. It's 24 amp. Okay, cool. Yeah, Gareth, that was the one I was talking about. Let me grab that. Cone XP Pro Air. I guess we could do an unboxing, but I won't have the cool top-down view. I like the Cone XP Air or XP a lot because of the size. It is a nice big mouse. Is that in focus? Great. It is. So the Cone XP is nice, and I like the idea of a wireless mouse when it works, but the issue I've had with wireless mice is the battery life is typically terrible, and I don't like having to charge them all the time. So I end up always sticking with a wired mouse. I'm not a pro level FPS player with mouse, so to me wireless is still going to be okay. But if this has better battery life, not whatever the rating is, but actual real world battery life with RGB on, great. Usually the long battery life is when you shut off all the lights, which kind of defeats the purpose. But I do like that the new one has that quick charge dock. So depending on how well that works, the Rock Hat Leader from I think 4 or 5 years ago, I have that one. That mouse is really heavy, but the battery life was okay. It was just really cumbersome to dock all the time. So I'm hoping this is like a better version of all of that, kind of like a spirit animal, better spirit animal to the leader. Okay, so all I'm going to do is try the power supply here, because I don't want to kill the chat for or disappear for 2 minutes while I dig out my multimeter from the garage. And then I can always try to unbox the Cone XP Air and give my first thought impressions if I'm allowed to talk about it. But if it's on pre-order, I'm sure there's some wiggle room. I'll just check embargo so I don't make my contact at Rock Hat upset. All right, I'm going to plug this in. I'll be back. This is a very loose power cord. Maybe that's part of the problem. See, I heard a pop just then. That's not good. Let's see. I'm going to let it discharge. And depending on what it does, I may actually just plug into that one to see if it turns on. Just swap the front plate out. Yeah, I can hear it click. Did they put the op amps in right? So the op amps are installed correctly. I could see if they weren't, that preventing it from powering on. The reason why I like the Burson Audio Funk is because it has op amps, basically, that aren't soldered. Let me see if I can get one out. So, oh man, this is going to be tough. Let's see how close I can get. That little guy with the little, I guess you can see the 8 prongs on the end. This is a very cheap op amp, and it sounds fairly neutral. It measures okay. Yeah, it's the, I'll just read it, the JRC B1064. So they sell what's called a Vivid op amp and a Classic op amp. And the reason why this is cool is you can basically swap out the op amps to tune the sound of your amplifier. There's tons of potential with that. Let's see, you have, the ones they sell are larger, and I have installed in my Fun right now. But you can get Burr Brown, you can buy Texas Instrument ones, and as long as it's this dual channel versus single channel, as long as you get the dual channel on this, it'll work fine. They're not swappable between each other, unfortunately, because this uses singles versus double on this. I'm really shocked that that did not work. I thought a brand new board would do it, so I may swap back. Just to get some audio. I'd love to at least hear this thing functional. The other one just had a staticky headphone out, and that was it. I should try my other power supplies, but... Yeah, so whoever's new to the chat, if you have questions, feel free to shout. Ask anything you want. I might just open the XP Air and maybe we'll wrap up the stream on that. If this is uneventful and I get nothing out of this, then there's no point in continuing this part of the video. I'll just have to email them. I mean, I could just have really bad luck. Other people have reviewed it and it's worked, so. Okay, plates off. Volume knob. Really stuck now. There we go. I'm mainly just going to plug in the other board into this and try to make sure I don't short out the bottom. But I really just want to see if it turns on. This should be okay as long as the grounding. So that's the thing, I may have to ground it. So I'm pretty sure I installed this correctly, so I think I'm going to swap it back to the one that used to work and see what's going on. Welcome to the chat and the stream for those who joined up. We were just talking audio and random products and answering questions, so if you want to talk about anything, just drop it in chat. I'll do my best to answer it and get my bearings here. Okay. Right now I'm just swapping this PCB back to the one that it came with that I know worked, just was not perfect, because this is driving me crazy. I guess I should have switched out the op amps.
Well, those are okay.
Yeah. They got for this huge cheap mouse pad. I don't have to worry about destroying my desk.
Is that, I don't know how to say, is it Famesy?
Thanks, Famesy, I appreciate that. It's late where you are. Appreciate the support. Okay, so I think I got everything? Maybe one screw in the back, I believe. Yeah. So that's interesting. Okay. So this was supposed to be the new PCB, and it did not solve my issue. I guess I can always, because my issues with the old one was the headphone jack was really staticky. I couldn't get a good connection. So I might just resolder it, I guess. We're going to switch it back, though. And I'm going to pray that I have something functional. Otherwise, I just wasted a lot of time here. Yeah, it's getting later. Not bad. Okay, this sits nice. Let's check the headphone pins. All right. Well, I'm going to ground it and just power it on. And then we'll see. Chat's picking up some viewers. Feel free to ask whatever you want. I can talk about other stuff not related to this. So, audio, music, gaming, new products, opinions on things, troubleshooting, I will try my best there. That can be a little more time consuming, but if you're here and you have questions, drop it in chat. And thanks for stopping by. This was not scripted. I just figured I was doing an amp repair, and I might as well turn on the camera while I do it in case I can chat with you. That is weird. That's not threading in well. All right, we're good.
See, which gaming headset?
Oh, man. Yeah, see, that's the tough one. I get asked that a lot. So it depends what you're playing it on and what your equipment is. I really think there's a lot to do with EQ, soundstage, noise isolation, driver matching. A lot of people don't realize how important it is that the left and right driver have almost the exact same spec. And when I say almost the exact, I'm talking like it should be a 0.03% difference across the board in what you can measure. So I like the VZR Model 1s. I think they're a great headset. I talk about them a lot. I don't prefer them specifically for music listening, for all the stuff I listen to, because I find that vocals and some guitar or string instruments kind of take a step back for sound quality. However, and if you play Call of Duty Warzone, there's a couple times that they do those limited time modes, and one of them was as long as you won in Gulag, you could respawn and get back into Warzone. And I was having a rough game that game, just poor timing, you know, rushing the wrong spot, whatever it may be, whatever excuse I can make, I guess. But every time I got in Gulag, it was you versus just that one other person, and the freaking Model 1s really came in clutch. I knew exactly where they were every single time I was playing in Gulag, and I ended up winning 7 Gulags in one game simply because I knew exactly where they were coming. Now, again, I don't think it's perfect for critical music listening. It's not the right headset for everyone because the microphone's a little bit quieter and some people really need a loud mic. But damn, I seriously heard everything that was going on, and that has to do with how aggressive they are with driver matching. Yeah, the games help a lot too, and choosing the right EQ for your hearing. So footsteps, depending on the game, there'll be a different frequency response or frequency range, and some headsets excel at some frequencies versus others. But the Vic, so when I was talking to him, they have the measurements of each driver for every single headset they make, and they hand select 2 drivers to match each other. So even though, you know, one headset might sound slightly different than the other, it's still going to be close. I don't think the human ear can, most like 99.9% people won't be able to hear much of a difference between the two headsets. However, when you get ones that are perfectly symmetrical to each other, that gives you really advanced imaging performance. And I think that's super, super critical. I've had some headsets that I measure them because I have a headphone measuring rig. I actually measure frequency response, channel matching, and all that. I've had some that are off by like a few percent, like some cheaper Corsairs, for example, the driver matching wasn't that great. And whether you EQ or not, you can fix bass response and treble, but there are slightly off phasing issues, whatever it may be. You can't tell where the footsteps are accurately. You get crushed because you have no idea where you're getting hit from. So I think the new Novas did a really good job with imaging, at least my pairs. It's been easier to catch footsteps with. I do like the Model 1. I do think Turtle Beach. Now this is driving me crazy because I'm getting no power here. Did this unplug? So I did something, guys, that is killing power, which makes me feel good about the other one because I can switch back. But what got unplugged? I don't believe I left anything out. Yeah, for wireless, let's see. The Odyssey Penrose is great for wireless on imaging, but not great on comfort, and they're a little buggy. The battery life actually sucks too. The Turtle Beach Stealth 700, the Gen 2 Max, they had a firmware update recently. They're actually a really good headset if you switch the audio preset to vocal. It fixes some of the weird frequency issues with it, and it ends up being a really solid FPS wireless headset. Otherwise, probably the Nova, if you can get past the comfort issue. The Nova Pro wireless is great. It just has some really, really questionable bumps in the ear cup. But I'm trying to think if there's any other wireless one I'd recommend for like ultimate FPS placement. I'm looking at most of my... The Astro A50s are older, but they actually have pretty good imaging for footsteps. They just don't do great on a lot of other things. But that's actually not a bad option if you can get them on a good price. Problem right now is the Nova Pros are out, and they're arguably better across the board aside from the comfort. Much more modern tech, so I'd probably consider the Nova Pro over the A50, whereas before the A50 was probably one of my top choices. So yeah, so you know what's funny, the A20 Gen 2s sound better than the A50s in my opinion. They sound amazing. It's their later tech and their EQ that they chose on it is awesome. The comfort's not that great and the microphone's not great. I think you're paying the $120 solely for how good the sound quality is. So for that, for the money, those things are killer. I actually really like them. I would have used them more often if I didn't have other ones that are a little bit better in the other aspects like comfort and stuff. So this is officially has me stumped because normally all you have to do is tap that. Oh my gosh, so I finally figured out what I did wrong. I'm going to show you, because I'm really disappointed with myself. This is what I get for not triple checking everything. I'm going to swing around, because you got to see a close-up of this horrible fail. Okay, so you can see if it comes into focus. There are, let me try zooming in actually. These pins right here, that's the board to turn it on and off. I assume that if I just slid it in and lined up these knobs, that I'd be good to go on everything else. But it turns out that row of pins missed the secondary motherboard, or the little side PCB. So that's why I'm not seeing a light. So I don't know if you heard what I just said, but I basically didn't align the pins right, which is why I'm not seeing an LED or a power button that's functioning. So that was annoying as hell. I did see the mods that the Techni made to the Penrose. It has a giant pad on the headband and the ear cups are huge. The issue with that is when you put huge pads on a headset that wasn't really meant for that, you're really screwing with the soundstage and the imaging. So yeah, it's more comfortable, but you're not going to get the same precision and sound quality that you would have had if you didn't modify the pad. I don't mind modifying pads. There are some headsets where I actually think you have to modify the pad. The Corsair Virtuoso, in my opinion, is one that really benefits from pad swapping. So it's not terrible. You can apply some EQ fixes to it, and that does help. It does have a high clamp force, so I guess that's going to dull that down a little bit if you have a great pad. But you can try it, and depending on where you buy it, you can always give that a shot and see if you like it enough in that configuration. And if you do, great, just keep it. I think that I really like planar magnetic headphones and drivers anyway.
Yeah, you know, it's...
I'm trying to think if there's stuff that I would justify modding. I agree to an extent of what you're saying, Gareth, or Famesy. My thing is if the only headset that fits my criteria of sound performance is 300 and the only drawback is comfort, then fixing the comfort makes it the perfect headset for me. So I'm not saying that that one is the perfect one for me, but that's been my philosophy on a couple ones. I use the Virtuoso XT a lot for daily use for work because how solid the mic is, and it's for my conference calls and stuff for work. I'm not a fan of it for gaming. It's outclassed by other headsets for the same price point. But it needed pads. It felt too loose without using stock pads, and they weren't that comfortable. I didn't have a good seal, which hurt bass response. After a while, they felt a little warm. So to me, the only way to make that one work every day for work was to pad swap it. I still think there's headsets good enough. Oh, this is loose. That's probably part of it. That capacitor is barely on there. I mean, for $300, it's kind of like we should stop making excuses for these companies. I tend to try to avoid saying I have favorites, but I can tell you after the most recent firmware updates, for the money, a lot of people sleep on that Turtle Beach 700 Gen 2 Max. That thing has some awesome sound quality when you tune it. It's really comfortable. Simultaneous Bluetooth. It works cross-platform, so it works on PC, Xbox, and PlayStation, wireless with chat. Really comfortable. The mic is great. The mic's actually not far behind Corsair. So that's been, to me, the best bang for your buck headset out there, especially because now it's like a 40 or 50 hour battery life. It's 40 plus. I get closer to 45, 50. So it's out there on my wall of frequently tested headphones. I actually have like 4 or 5 headsets that I keep out no matter what I'm reviewing. And I compare what I'm reviewing to those benchmark headsets because I know where their pros and cons are. The VZR Model 1, wherever that is, being one of them. Jesus, I'm installing this backwards as I'm talking. So, let me see if I'm getting off track here. Yeah, I agree that, you know, when you're starting to spend $300+, I think it should just overall be well enough engineered to fit everything you're looking for appropriately and not feel like they skimped out. I don't understand how Sony, with all their resources and manufacturing power and economy of scale, can make a $280 headset like this and have such a crappy microphone. Battery life's okay. I don't get why the Pulse 3D headset, which is $100, Sony allows you to custom EQ it on your PlayStation 5 to make it sound exactly how you want it, but they don't let you do that with the InZone H9, which is almost $300. Artificial lockouts is just the stupidest thing in the world. And Sony is the only one that allows their own headsets to do game chat and audio control. So if you're playing FPS and you need to turn your friends down, you have to get an InZone headset or their Pulse. All the others with USB only do one channel for all of it, your chat and your voice. And your game. So you have to adjust it through the console controller. Just press the audio button online. So that's been annoying.
Yeah, the Elite Pro 2 was awesome.
That kind of set the benchmark back then by quite a bit. I cannot believe I missed the pins earlier. If that's all it took, man, I'm going to be excited because I've been dying to play with this amp.
What happened here?
And if I didn't fully answer someone's question, I'm sorry. Like I said, I can go off on little tangents.
so let me know. I'll keep checking chat. I really would love to get this freaking thing working. The Elite Atlas, yeah, man. So I'll give you a little secret. I'm trying not to spill too much of my future content plans. However, a lot of companies use the same driver for different headsets. Turtle Beach uses their, they call it the NanoClear driver. But I can tell you, I take apart a lot of the headsets I review, and I'm finding the same driver in like 2/3 of the wireless headsets I review. At least half. They all look the same. And usually they're 50 millimeter. And they have these little ridges on the driver and stuff. They sound good. After that, it just comes down to the design of the ear cup, the ear pad, the DSP, and how it sounds and everything. But the Stealth 700 Gen 2 and the Gen 2 Max is built off the same ear cup and driver technology as the Elite. I'm drawing a blank, so I'm going to look and cheat. Where is it? Yeah, the Elite Atlas Aero. I have both, and I've A-B'd them. They have a very, very similar sonic signature to them, like almost identical. So that is essentially the new version. It just doesn't have PC-specific features. But with the thanks to Bluetooth, it kind of makes the Atlas Aero irrelevant, in my opinion, just because it's... You're getting almost everything that the Elite Atlas Aero does, plus cross-platform and Bluetooth. So, sorry, I gotta make sure I'm coordinating them with the family here. I'm dying to get this to work.
Yeah, I hope. With Sony in-zone headsets, I'm really disappointed they're more geared for PC.
Yeah, just stocks down on PlayStation, but at least you get the game to chat mix on PlayStation, which to me is the biggest reason why I would use it. They actually sound great on certain games. I liked them for Gran Turismo a lot. On Call of Duty, I actually just did like a 1.5 hour play test with a bunch of headphones on Warzone. I lined it up this time, guys. Maybe this will work. And the end zones just don't give me the same FPS awareness that the Novas do. The Novas are superior at that price range when it comes to footsteps. So, you know, and I can use the Novas on my Xbox. The Sony, you think with the end zone, they would have given at least the option to have an aux input as a fallback, and then you could justify using it for every platform you're playing on, but I'm pretty sure they did it to make sure there's no way it could use it on Xbox, because that's how Sony usually operates. If it had an aux, it would have been great, but there are not many good wireless headsets that work on all platforms, and that's kind of why I throw out the 700 Gen 2 Max a lot, is because I think they actually pulled that off really well with the new model. All right, I'm just going to put two screws in. My op amps are installed. I actually lined up the damn pins this time. You know what? I'm just going to plug it in. I'll deal with the volume after. Moment of truth. That sounded good. There's a light! Wow. So I just spent an hour and a half switching a board out because I didn't line up some pins. But it works. Let's check the... Yes. There we go. Now I'm in headphone mode. Speaker mode. This actually has two dedicated amplifier stages built into it. The larger transistors on the back are your AB speaker output, or left and right channel, so it's discrete. And then I have the smaller transistors up front for my headphone out. This is an incredibly powerful little amp, and I'm so excited it works. Yeah, no, the original Pro Wireless was tuned better out of the box. You have to tune the Novas more. I usually big into tuning. I like tuning to get to my exact audio profile that I like. But it's really annoying that the Nova Pros, you can't assign custom EQs from Sonar onto it so it can work on console.
they advertise the crap out of Sonar with PC use, or with console. In my opinion, it was confusing. And it's really unfortunate that you can't benefit from all of those custom EQ options. Yeah, so I did a custom EQ preset for Warzone specifically, which cut back some of the bass, but I measured it, and it was almost the exact same frequency response, like within a couple decibels across the board for Warzone on the built-in DAC EQ compared to Sonar's Warzone pre-built profile. So on Sonar, you can pick their own custom presets to tune it for whatever game you're playing on PC, which is great, but it stinks you can't use it on console. So what I do is I measure the frequency response of the headset on PC with that preset. Then I built the same profile using the DAC's built-in EQ presets until I could get the same exact measured audio output. So I can clone Sonar performance for console. And once you do that, it helps step up the competitiveness a little bit more for console if you're really hell-bent on tuning it to that level. So, but they're both good. I don't think anyone who owns an Arctis Pro needs to upgrade to the Nova unless there's something specific you like about it, like ANC. But I really don't like that bump for the ANC mic. This is so exciting, guys. I could actually hear this today. I'm going to use the built-in op amps and not start swapping them out until I see how this performs so I can get a good feel for it. As I'm talking, SteelSeries goes live. Yeah, well, I mean, Planar Magnetics is out. The problem is the cost goes up and then your power requirements go up. But planar magnetics destroy most dynamic drivers in this price range. They cost more, but 300 to 400 versus, you know, 100 to 300 for most popular gaming headphones, the planar is just on another level when it comes to detail retrieval. It just comes down to tuning and comfort. The Penrose tuning out of the box has amazing mid-range, but the bass is a little lacking, and the highs they have emphasis on very specific frequencies, so it can actually be a little bit fatiguing. But in other parts, they're not that bright or airy. You have to EQ it to boost it a little bit. Problem is, when I do that, it makes some parts hurt more. So they're not perfect, but the mid-range is amazing. For vocals, it's insane. Oh, this is working. I'm actually going to hear it. So hopefully the stream looks okay. I'm streaming off a laptop using the built-in video card, and I've never built a streaming profile on it. I just used NVENC, the media encoder from NVIDIA, and set it to like, I think 8 megs a second or something. I think I can go up to 30. All right, I'm going to power it on one more time. Then I'm going to move it back to the rack. Yes, it works. Give me 1 second. Chat, if you have questions, post them. I'm probably going to wrap up the stream here soon and go grab some food with the family. I'll do the wire management later. I'm just really excited to power this on. Okay. I hope it's lit up. All right. I have power. So, let's see. Actually, so surprisingly, footsteps in Warzone are in much lower frequencies than you expected. the weight of the footstep is in the 160 to 250 hertz range, and then mids to mid-high will be like the more detailed part of the footstep, depending on what material they're walking on. The issue is when you tune for footsteps in higher frequencies is you're also emphasizing other environmental frequencies, which can make the audio track a little bit more confusing or busy sounding, and it makes it harder to isolate the two. In a quiet spot, you know, no airstrikes or loot crates or whatever ringing, tuning specifically for footsteps can be helpful. It's just as soon as an airstrike happens or something else comes in, it might actually overpower the other part of the footstep, which is your lower frequency, and therefore make it even harder to hear. So pros and cons. I'll eventually do some more custom EQ. Damn, Gareth, you have some good eyes, man. So it's not a project turntable. I'll get on that in one sec, but just to finish up my statement. So I'll do some custom EQ videos for specifically, I guess, for Warzone tuning. I'll share it for Nova, but it also comes down to, again, the mix and the game. Because if I give you a custom EQ setting that's going to help with FPS, CSGO is going to be different than Apex, which is different than Destiny and Halo and Warzone. And it's very time consuming, and a lot of times you can start with like a canned preset and then just tune from there to make the most of it. So I'm probably going to get this video demonetized, which is fine. But I'm going to play a couple songs. I want to see if this works. I'm dying to hear something out of this amp. It works, guys. Woo! Alright, I just want to try this one part for imaging. Bear with me here. Just at the perfect time, right? That's a pretty damn good start. I am very excited that that's working, because that's a very tiny amp that you can use to power near field speakers. So super, super excited about that. Oh, cool. That's awesome. You must have a big collection. I have to get all of my records out of storage, but I have. Thank you, Famesy. Good luck, man. Have a good night. So the turntable, I'm actually using the Music Hall turntable, which I'm like 99% sure. I don't know how many components they share, but Music Hall shares parts with Project. Sorry if I keep pronouncing it wrong. So, sorry, I'm getting blown up with messages. But yeah, this is the Music Hall MMF 3.3. It's a walnut finish. It's a dual plinth table, so depending on which turntable you have, you may have a dual plinth if you recognize that. Using an Ortofone Red cartridge, and then I'm using a Vincent Audio PHO 500 phono preamp stage. I think those are about $700 for the phono preamp. It's a great phono preamp, considering it's solid state too. And then normally I power those speakers with the PS Audio Stellar Strata. It's a hybrid integrated amp, about $3,000. It's 150 watt times two. Tons of power for how small it is. It's this amp on the bottom. I don't know if you can see it on the stream. No, I guess not. I'll do a couple videos dedicated to that gear soon. But the imaging of that was actually really nice. Because of the whole fully discrete audio channel setup that's built inside, and it's a Class AB amplifier, so it actually has some really nice clean sound to it. I'm definitely going to be playing with that a lot. So hopefully that answered your question. I know I went off a tangent on the turntable, but This is a longer stream there, longer stream than I was expecting. So I'm probably going to wrap up here shortly, but I think the stream went well. I really appreciate you all hanging out and chatting while I worked on this board, because that's made it more fun than me just sitting here figuring out where my screw up was earlier. So, but yeah, I think we're going to wrap up the stream. If you guys have any final thoughts or questions, shoot it in chat. I'll stick around for a few minutes. I'm just going to respond to my wife real quick, and then I'll check chat here, and then stay tuned. I think I'm going to... Oh no, I soundproofed my room, Gareth. Before my house, so I built this house new, and I got to customize everything, and this entire room is soundproofed, even the interior walls. So I can blast it, and you can't hear crap. I can get the interior pressurized a lot. So I didn't know you were from Dublin. That's cool. So let's see. All right, so respond to that. So we got still have 6 people hanging out, at least according to this. If anyone has questions, let me know. Otherwise, I'm going to wrap up here soon. And can't thank you enough for all the support. I think we're about to hit 14,000 subs, which, considering the long hiatus I took, I'm really excited about the growth. Yeah, we're getting there. 13,941. I'm really excited about that amp. Finally works. It was just because of a user error. I'm going to pull up a different song. Now that I know I demonetized this video because I played a copyrighted song. Let's see. I'm going to pull up one of my audio demo songs. So we still got a few people watching. Let me know if you guys are curious about anything else. Otherwise, I'm going to play a track on the closing here. Try a little, some acoustic or some rock. Wish I had a little bit more overhead. Yeah, the H9 would be better if you don't need active noise cancellation. The H9's a better value. They're almost the same headset, just different ear pad material and no ANC for the most part. I just wanted to see how good the ANC was, and it's not bad, but I wish that got louder. The other track was much louder. This one's a softer track, but... sounds nice, though. I wonder how that sounds to you guys. Hear this one part. Figure out a way to boost the audio output of that a little bit. Yeah, I think that's about it. So it looks like everyone's wrapping up. Appreciate you all stopping by. I'm gonna end the stream on that note, and thank you all again. And I have some good reviews coming. The next review is probably that Burson audio amp, and then I'm gonna get into the Sonys before I get into everything else. But I have a lot slated. So thank you again, and I'll see you soon. Take care.